Hello everyone, this is Bitcoin Sofia, and today we're gonna talk about the fee markets. This is part one of the three-part series on the fee markets. In the first video, I'm gonna be talking about what was before the fee markets, and that is zero confirmation feature. That feature was pretty simple. Since a transaction sent by anybody could not be rewritten, any transaction that is already received by the nodes or any transaction that already reached the mempool can be considered safe, which meant that the moment a transaction is sent to the whole network, it can be considered paid. Yes, it is still not in a block, but it is safe enough to buy a cup of coffee. And that's what it was intended for. It was intended for small payments, for quick payments. Imagine going in a shop and standing in line, your turn is up, and you say, I want to pay with Bitcoin. They say, okay, here is your QR code, pay. You send the money, and then they say, I'm sorry everyone, the queue has to stop, we have to wait 10 minutes until this person gives us the money, until it's in a block. That's ridiculous. So, zero confirmation is the feature where a wallet recognizes that a transaction is sent, even if it's not yet in a block, even if it's just in the mempool. It is less secure, but way, way more convenient than waiting for blocks. Okay, so let's talk about the different problems with it and the different benefits of it. The most obvious benefit is, of course, the quickness. Many new chains used the slow block time of Bitcoin as their selling point. For example, Litecoin claims that it is fast because its blocks are produced every 2.5 minutes. But if Bitcoin transactions can be near instant, what does it matter how fast the blocks are produced? The reason blocks are kept at 10 minutes is to avoid orphan blocks. And orphan blocks are a topic for another video. Maybe I'll make it soon, I don't know. But this is a major selling point for many cryptocurrencies. That's their main selling point. We have high throughput. You can just send a transaction and it's received instantly. Bitcoin has that. It's been there since day one. It's been present all the time. So, what are the risks? Because yes, while it exists as a feature, it is not as safe transaction secluded in a block. So what are the risks? Firstly, there is the risk that because it is not included in a block, it can be censored. If more than 51% of the miners... I realized I have made a mistake. No, you do not need 51% of the miners. You only need one block. As long as a miner who agrees with you to mine the next block in a way that undermines your zero-conf transaction, then yeah, you cheated. It's successful. Mempool transactions cannot override block transactions. Just because something conflicts with somebody's mempool doesn't mean that person is gonna reject the block. The concept behind this is that while you cannot override a transaction that is already sent, there is no guarantee that everyone received it. And there is no guarantee that the other people wouldn't agree with the second transaction that you sent. This is a decentralized network, and there is no single authority to say this one gets in, this one doesn't. So different nodes have different views on what the mempool looks like. And because of that, they cannot just reject a block that includes a transaction that they expected when they expected something else. That is why a single minor is enough to undermine zero confirmation. That is quite a bit less secure than I expected, but even so, for most cases like buying coffee or groceries, it should be secure enough. Next problem is that it is theoretically possible to hack zero-conf transaction. Now, it is only theoretically possible. I don't believe it can be done in practice. How? How is it possible? Okay, so since this is a transaction that exists in the mempool of every Bitcoin node in the world, in order to hack it, in order to delete it, you have to first disable the internet of every computer in the world, because you don't know which computers are nodes and which aren't. Next, once you do that, you have to... why are you disabling the internet first? You're disabling it because you want people to stop propagating that transaction. If you're just deleting it from one place and it goes back there from another, that doesn't work for you if you're the hacker. So the hacker needs to stop the internet. Step two is to distribute a virus, a malware, on every single Bitcoin node. And that malware would delete everything, because again, you don't know how the mempool is organized in every single node. There are different node implementations, there are different nodes. So some would probably be enough to just restart the computer. With some, yeah, just restart the computer, the mempool would be in the RAM memory, it will disappear. However, with some, there might be a backup. You don't know that. There are many different Bitcoin implementations. Some of them are not public. You don't know how they work. You don't know if they do backups on the disk. So, you have to count for that as well. You have to delete stuff. You have to search for stuff. That is a pretty smart virus. That's a pretty smart malware. And once you do all of that, if you leave even one node untouched, it will simply propagate the transaction once more. It will simply send it to everyone else once again. Do you see where the problem is? Oh, did I mention? All of that has to happen in under 10 minutes. Yeah, if you want to hack zero-conf, you have to do it in all the computers in the world, under 10 minutes. That is why hacking is only in theory. So, is zero-conf safe? It is safe enough to buy coffee. It is safe enough to go to a store, get some groceries, and pay without having to make the whole line of people wait, the whole queue. It's safe enough to be used in practice. Okay, that's for the first video. In the second video, I'm gonna be talking about how zero-conf got disabled and how it got re-enabled in Bitcoin Cash. Bye bye. I just wanted to mention something really quickly. In the description below this video, you will find three links. First is the Facebook group of this channel, where we can discuss stuff as they happen. Next, there is also my personal blog about Bitcoin programming, where I write tutorials about using Bitcoin and writing code for it. And lastly, there is the Bitcoin Cash meetup in Sofia that I'm organizing. It's going to happen monthly, and I'll be very happy if you come. I'll be happy to talk with you, and you can learn stuff there. Okay, bye bye.